Well, welcome everybody with this talk about running your mainframe on Linux for fun and profit. I have a couple of slides. I don't try to do death by PowerPoint. It's LibreOffice, so it's no PowerPoint, but anyway, you get the picture. I often wander off in saying strange stuff that's supposed to be funny. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. I don't care if you don't. And there's a demo in it as well, so I'll start my mainframe on my laptop and give you an impression of how that works. First, who am I? My name is Jeroen Baten in Dutch. I'm from the Netherlands. I've been in IT since I was, I guess, 15, doing stuff with computers. So these days I sort of call myself an innovator. I do trainings, I do software development, I do consultancy, whatever comes by that's fun to do. So I call myself mostly a solutionist. I provide solutions. People have different challenges, problems, and I try to solve them. I've written several books. And I'm also the dad of five girls. So you see a couple of pictures of the books, and I also have a couple of pictures of me, sort of. On the right upper side, that's our car. We have a girl in a wheelchair, so that's a wheelchair-adapted van. And for my birthday, my wife put some Linux chucks on the both sides of them, which was a great gift, of course. I've also been active in the Boy Scout movement, or the scout movement these days, of course, because there's also a lot of girls in the picture. I've been a volunteer firefighter. That's where I rescued a dog from a lake. And that's, of course, weird, because dogs are excellent swimmers, but it was in the middle of the winter, the lake was frozen except for a big hole in the middle, and there he was swimming, so at some point he would be hypothermic and drown, so we saved him. And he was, of course, a little cold. And on the right, lower side, you see my firefighter helmet, and the bottom part of it is melted. It was a little warm, but it was an exercise situation, so that's the good news. My main project, I'm also the project leader of an open source project called LibrePlan. It's a web-based project management application. I think it's very cool. It's got lots of features in it, but that's not the subject of this talk today. So, sorry. The other thing, I can skip this one, is, well, what is a mainframe? That's what the talk is about. And for to go back into history, mainframes sort of started in the 50s and 60s as being big. And it was the way to get things done in those days. And what typically describes a mainframe system is that it's got its whole design is massive, maximized throughput. So trying to get as much data as possible in as short as possible time from A to B. So it's throughput. And that's not a supercomputer. A supercomputer is one where the calculations need to be as fast as possible, but your input file can be a one line, and the output can also be a one line, but you need to have really quick calculation. With a mainframe, it's as much data from A to B. And the way they solve that in the mainframe world is they use massive parallelization in hardware. So they try to offload work from the CPU to other parts of the system. So the CPU is only used for the really essential stuff. So, for instance, if you need some data, the CPU will just request a storage controller, give me some data. The storage controller will figure out where the data is residing, on what hard disk. It will read it, it will cache it, whatever. And that's a separate piece of hardware in the system. So they do that with storage, they do that with memory allocation, they do that with networking as well. So they try to do as much as possible into dedicated hardware components. And that's why it's also called a big iron system, because, well, it's a lot of iron. Actually, I was offered recently an old mainframe system, and it wasn't big, it was just 1 cubic meter of almost solid metal, so 200, 300 kilograms. And it's the first time that my wife said no regarding my hobby of acquiring stuff. I have also two AS400s, so maybe I was stretching it a little bit when I came with a mainframe. So that's what a mainframe is. Now, what is Hercules? Hercules is a mainframe emulator. So it emulates System 370, the ESA 390, and the 64-bit Z architecture. And you're all familiar, I guess, with an emulator, what an emulator is. Who isn't familiar with what an emulator is? Okay, who is not familiar with what virtualization is? Okay, so I can skip that. The thing is, Hercules does software emulation. So the chip codes, the CPU codes from the IBM mainframes have been the same since the 50s. And it's not x86 code, it's not PowerPC or MIPS or ARM. You know, it's dedicated mainframe CPU. Which means that the software translates the CPU codes into the codes for your native platform, which gives you a slowdown performance of one CPU, mainframe CPU instruction will be approximately 100 CPU instructions on your Intel box. So that makes it slower. But since the 50s, hardware has increased tremendously, so you'll see it performs pretty good. It runs on Linux, Windows, Solaris, FreeBSD, and macOS. So you can choose whatever platform you have. You can just install a Hercules. Well, how does it look? On the left side, you have the front panel of an actual IBM mainframe. And you see this rotary dial stuff. And on the right side, you see the GUI, which also has those rotary dials. And sort of the operator console with the logging beneath that. Well, what does Hercules do? Well, it runs software. There is many operating systems are available in the public domain. And if you have a license for an IBM operating system, as well as the hardware, so you need the hardware to be allowed to run the same operating system on Hercules, you can run the closed source operating systems, but there's also a lot of offerings in the public domain. And this is way before open source or free software was a thing. But up until 1972, 73, the development of mainframe operating systems was funded by the American government. So one of the provisions was that they should publicize source code. So up until 1972, 73, the source code for those operating systems are just publicly available. Today, I will concentrate my talk on MVS as an operating system, and I'll tell you why. What happened with me, and this is what I'm now going to tell you is the mistakes I made, the obvious mistakes I made, and that's why I'm doing this talk, because working with MVS on Hercules is fun, but there are some big potholes that you should avoid. And they're easy to avoid, so that's why I'm doing this talk. The other thing is, I know nothing about mainframes. I'm not a mainframe specialist. I've written several books on Linux. So Linux, yeah. Kubernetes, you know, Docker, virtualization, KVM, OpenNebula, you name it, I got it. Mainframe, I don't. But at the same time, it was fun. And I'm telling you, this talk is about fun and profit. But Profit comes later. So, what not to do? Well, if you Google the Hercules Project, you are presented with a website, hercules.org. Don't go there. Latest update is in 2010, but it's way down at the bottom. So you don't see it at first. And what you do see on that site is there is a turnkey MVS system that you can download for easy install, and you try it, and it doesn't really work that easy. You follow it to the project leader, which is Jay Maynard on this site, and you think, okay, let's contact him. So I did, and it's like writing an email to Dev Null. Nothing happens. No reply. It's what we call in Netherlands, the lights are on, but there's nobody home. So that was weird. And at some point I thought, okay, let's abandon this. But I didn't. I continued. And long time I thought, this guy, he was deceased. I mean, it's possible. People do die at the end. So maybe it's an old project and the guy is buried somewhere. And then on May 1st of this year, I am dead. A posting in a mainframe MVS news group from Jay Maynard. And it turns out that he's now active together with Eric Raymond on an open source project to make an open source UPS system, so both hardware and software, which is a cool project. And he said, I may not be involved in Hercules anymore, but I haven't gone anywhere. So he just lost interest. Okay, that's all good and fine. It happens in open source. But please transfer management of your stuff to the rest of the world. Because there are more people working with this stuff than just this guy, turns out. So what should you do? Well, they have a new website, hercules390.eu. And that one is actively maintained. There is a mailing list on the Yahoo groups, and it has 7,000 members. So it's not a small community. It's active, it's thriving. People are playing around with it, developing applications on it. It's alive. Oh my God, it's alive. And the turnkey system turns out to be now version 4 minus to be exact. And you can easily download it. It's a zip file, and it's very simple. Download the zip file, unpack the zip file. There's a shell script or a batch file called MVS. Just type MVS, and you've got a running system. And then you need to start learning. And there is this guy called Moshix on YouTube. He by now has, it's 60 plus, it's at the moment it's 85. He's got 85 videos explaining every possible angle there is about MVS, how it works, what you can do with it, how to install software, and it's an excellent way to get to learn this. There's also the Kuma IT channel. He's got 20 tutorial videos. Those are good, but he stopped making them, so Moshix is active. Kumar is at the moment not active, but still has valuable content on YouTube. So what do you need? Well, what you need is a computer with Linux. Yeah, or Windows, I know, that's also possible, but I'm a Linux fan, so let's focus on Linux. You can do it on a Raspberry Pi. And it's the same zip file, because the script in the zip file will look at the architecture you're running, so it's easy peasy. You need a 3270 terminal emulator to make a connection to your mainframe. So you can start your mainframe, but to actually start typing stuff, you need a 3270 terminal emulator, which is in all the distributions it's available. So you just do apt-get or yum install x3270 and you've got it. You need a Hercules software and then some operating system distribution on top of Hercules, because you can install multiple operating systems. But like I said, today we focus on MVS. So this is a picture of a Raspberry Pi Zero running Hercules. And it's put on top of a really original mainframe manual from IBM, just to give you an impression of the difference in size, of course. Okay, the other thing is you need to get acquainted with the lingo. They have their own terms. As we, in the Linux world, if I say the word kernel, everybody knows what I'm talking about. At least that's what I hope. the mainframe world has their own lingo. So DASD means direct attached storage device, what we today call a hard disk. But back in the day, when they started mainframes, it was paper tapes and punch cards and no hard disk. And at some point, somebody invented the hard disk, a huge box of 5 megabytes, no less. And they said, well, let's call this a directly attached storage device. So that's how DASD comes to life. TSO is a time-sharing option. So it makes a mainframe a multi-user system. So yeah, you can have a mainframe running single-user, which is, of course, a huge waste of money. But anyway, TSO, it's a term that comes by every so often. JES2 is a job entry system. You are familiar probably with a Linux system, and when you type in the back of it, every key you press is sent to the kernel and echoed back to the screen, and it's a serial connection. With a mainframe, it's screen-oriented, so the mainframe will send you a complete screen, you will enter stuff in it, and you press the enter key will send the enter data back to the system, which will do some stuff and present you a new screen. So it's another way of being interactive. KIX is the front end to transactional software. So you can use KIX to make a screen layout for an application, and at the back of it you have a database. So and KIX is the IBM term, and the open source one is KIKS. And the other thing is, they're talking about data sets. What the hell is a data set? Well, the funny thing is, if you go to a mainframe admin and you say, I have a project, he will ask you, what's going to be the size of your project? He says, well, maybe I'll spend 10 megabytes on it. And then you get a data set, or a data partition, of 10 megabytes. So there is no a quota involved, or it's a sort of physical, well, it's not physical, it's a software, but it's a limitation on what you can do. And on this data set, there you can, in those data set, that data set, you can create files and work on those files. And the catalog is what we would call the path. So the catalog contains the description of the installed software on the system. And once you get this up and running, what do you see? It looks like this. So this is the logon screen. And after that, you get a menu. So in the demo that I'll show you in a few minutes, you will see the same. You have first the logon screen and then this menu system. And on the right side, you see an extra window with specialized keys, because on a 3270 terminal you have extra function keys, not only the F1 to F24, so it's not 12 but it's 24. But there are some things that you should know. For instance, F3 is the one to always get you one level up in your menu. So if you select a menu option and you go down a menu, you go down a menu, you go down a menu, F3 will get you back up. And the other thing is, because it's screen-oriented, page up and page down didn't work at those days, so they had to implement that in function keys. So F7 and F8 page up and page down. That's about all you need to know, so F3 and F7, F8. But one pretty important thing, if you type something wrong in the terminal, the terminal itself will lock. So not a lockup screen with a password, but it just doesn't understand what you're doing, and it will lock. And when it locks, you will see an X appear at the bottom row of the screen. And then there's a special reset key that you can find. I don't know if my pointer is working. Yeah, it is working. So here you have your reset key, right? And that will just reset the terminal, and then you can continue your session. Okay? So that makes it demo time. Okay, everybody up for demo? Nodding is yes and shaking is no. Okay, people laughing, so they are still awake. That's also very assuring. Okay, let's see if I can get this right. It's always a challenge because I'm doing stuff here and you're seeing stuff there. So let me... I'm getting old. So first, let me... You see nothing at the moment, I'm assuming. I'll mirror the displays like so. Okay. Yeah, you see the same as I do. Is it readable? Yeah, I'm looking at the last three there. So it's readable for you, then it's readable for them as well, I'm assuming. Okay. Otherwise you need glasses in front, you know. Okay. So I've just unzipped the zip file, the latest version. And as you can see, there is here the MVS and on Windows MVS.bat. And you can do a start Hercules if you like without MVS, but I'll not trouble you with that. So I just start MVS. And now it's booting the mainframe. So you get a logging message. It's trying to attach the DAS-D devices. Those are the directly attached storage devices. I'll just make a new tab, X3270. And this is my terminal. So, like so. And I'll connect to localhost. And I'll... So, is this sort of readable? A little bit, right? Let's see if I can do a color scheme. That's not good. This is very bad. Oh, okay. Ah, right. Is this readable? Yeah, it is sort of, right? Okay. I have my log. Okay, I'll continue now. The thing is, you back in the day, you could do your user ID, and if I then press enter, it will ask me for my password. But it's 1972, and security is not that much like it is today. So I can just do a slash, and then do a password after that. Easy peasy. Okay. A broadcast, no broadcast messages from the system. There is a fortune cookie, and I press enter again, and then I get my menu. Maybe I can even enlarge it a little bit. I don't know if that works. Yeah. Oh, cool. It works. So, like so. Yeah. Now, suppose that I type some really weird stuff. At the bottom, now you see this red X, right? And I have to press the reset button, and then the X will disappear. Okay. I go to the top, and I say, let's do option one. One. Why is my one not working? That's weird. Ah, run. Enter. Yay! Okay. There was already a one there. So it's a menu, and when I press F3, I get back up. I do the one again, and I'm here. I do the three. I do, and now I think I'll do a four. And it's a data source list. So it shows me all the data sources on the system. But I did this prior, so it already knows which library I want to look at. So it's this 2JCLib. And that's also the one that you'll find in the MoshX tutorial. And it shows me a whole list of data sets, but only one that fulfills the name. And I can do a select of this one to give me some information. I can F3 and I do an edit of the data set, and then I'm into the data set. So now I'm into my data set, and you see a lot of files. And I can do F7 and F8 to browse through the list. And what you see here, for instance, is prime number calculation assembler or prime number calculation COBOL. And of course, today when you stood up from your bed this morning, you just were dying to do some COBOL today, right? So we're going to have a look at COBOL. I put an E in front of it, press Enter, and now I'm into my editor. And it's very simple to make this, for instance, a B, or whatever, and I can just put a save here, enter, and my data is saved. It's as simple as that. A few things you need to know about editing a file like this. First is, the first line should start with a user ID, which in my case is HERC02, and then letter that I can use to distinguish between the different jobs that I'll submit to the system. So I've select A, but the next one I can do B, and the next one I can do C, or whatever. The other thing to know is a message class should be H, and H means that all the messages from this job that we will submit later on will be held into the system, and otherwise, if it would be an A or a B, it would go to a printer, printer A or printer B. And that's just the way that this Hercules system, his configuration is tuned. Well, tuned, not, but well, it's the way the way my virtual mainframe is configured. So when I'm done editing, or I can have a look at the bottom of it, it says I'm going to make 2,000 prime numbers. Let's make that 9,999 just for the fun of it. And I go up and I save this, enter. Now, if I do submit or sub, it will just submit this file into the job entry system. And it will do the compile, it will do the linking, it will do the running, and it will do the output all in one spool file, if everything works, of course. So I submit it, pressed enter, and it will show me, and it will say, okay, you have a job, and your job has a unique identifier, 0018. So to distinguish between all the other thousands of users on my system, mine would be job number 18. Now, I'll go back up the system, and I can go to option 8 for the output list, and there you have job number 18 already finished. And I can select it, and I can go through all the information. So it started at a certain time, it ended at a certain time. And here is the CPU elapsed time. So we are talking about 1,400ths of a second to calculate 10,000 prime numbers, compiling COBOL, and doing it all on my mainframe. Sorry, my mainframe. It's not a mainframe, it's my laptop, but it's an i7. It's decent performance. And if you go, then you get a source code, and then you get all the prime numbers that he has found up till 9999, which is 9,973 as the last largest prime number. So it's really pretty easy to work with a system like this. Right? Okay. So far so good. That was the demo. Let me then exit my menu. I do a shutdown. And now my Hercules will start a shutdown procedure. And at some point, it will wait a few seconds. So this can take about half a minute. And then I'll see the prompt again, and I can do other stuff. Okay. So it's time to go back to switch the display and continue the presentation. And now you have, it's always the same with this guy. Is this on the left or is it on the right? Hey, it's all right. Yay. That one should be... I'm lazy. Let's look. Works too. Presentation. There was my demo. Here was my demo. Start from current slide. And now, okay. So that was the demo, and it even worked, except for the little hiccup in the beginning, but it worked. Okay. Now, how about Hercules performance compared to an actual mainframe? So I'm comparing, Moshex did this on one of his videos. He's compared an i7 processor to a real IBM Z14, which is the latest hardware platform. And this is the performance of Hercules on an i7. And I point to this one, 344 MIPS per second. And this is done the same, but with an actual mainframe, which is 5 billion. So if you want to know the exact difference between the two, it's about 16 times faster. But it's not bad for an i7 compared to mainframe. But don't forget, it's not the same in throughput, right? A mainframe is massive throughput, and a PC is just a workstation. Even if it's in a 19-inch box, it's still a PC from the 80s. So, update in April 2018. Moshex by then had 61 instead of 41 videos. He made a TK4 system available, so you can mail him and ask for a user ID. So you even don't have to unzip a file if you're unable to unzip a distribution file and start an MVS script. I could say, I don't know what you're doing here, but that's maybe a little harsh. But you can just mail him and say, I want to log in on your system, and you get one on his Hercules VM. And I also did, and now that's where the profit starts coming in. I did a short poll on the S390 mailing group. There's 7,000 people active there, so I asked those people, "What's your age? What have you been doing with mainframes in the past?" And I got some 30-40 responses. So I did some statistics, and the average age is 62.6. who has a standard deviation of 12, which means these guys are becoming senior citizens, with all due respect, of course. But it also means that in a few years, most of those guys will retire. And then the profit part for my lecture comes into play, because there's a job opening if you're interested in this. There is a very humorous video on YouTube. Yeah, I know there are thousands of humorous videos, but this one was actually funny. It is a guy, an 18-year-old guy, a student, who bought a mainframe on an auction site, on eBay, I believe, for $300. So he went to his father and mother, I've just acquired a mainframe, and it's not that big. It's just one 19-inch rack. But it's 1.5 the normal width, and but full size. So he goes off to the school where they are selling this mainframe, and he puts everything in a van and goes home. And he's allowed to use the basement of the home for the mainframe, and you can't get a 19-inch rack from the front door to the basement, so he has to make a hole in the wall, so and excavate a part of the garden to slowly move the thing horizontally into the basement and then rotating it. And he did a talk about how he does that with pictures, and it's fun. And by the way, by now this guy is actually working at IBM at Poughkeepsie, IBM site, where he's actually working at their mainframe development branch. So he got a job out of it. And the other thing is, in this news group, I once put fairly simple, because I don't know this stuff, right? You saw that. And I thought, how hard can it be? Is there somebody who has an actual 3270 terminal that I can connect to my Hercules on my PC? Fairly innocent question. Yeah. What you need is, this is the Hercules, and it exits with a BNC coaxial connector that you have to connect to a concentrator. This thing weighs 30 kilograms with 2 5-and-a-quarter diskettes with the configuration in it, so you can configure stuff. Then this is the modem exit, SDLC, I believe, which I don't have any equipment for. But you can put a special expansion board into this contraption, and then it exits token ring. For people who are familiar with networking, token ring was what a lot of people did before Ethernet became sort of the standard. So from token ring, you go to the token ring hub. From the token ring hub, you go to, and that's not on this picture, but I acquired a Cisco 2950, which can route token ring to Ethernet, and then Ethernet can go into my simple, humble Dell PC with Hercules. And it's the whole bunch is 50 kilograms or something. It sort of becomes a hardware hobby in a way. But it's fun, you know. If you've done almost everything in Linux, then this is a completely new world. If this is too much work, no problem. There is a cool project on GitHub that uses Qt to emulate those really old Amber and Phosphor terminal screens. So it gives you that warm glow and it doesn't burn into your LCD screen, which the old screens used to do. During the preparation of this talk, I actually made a few new friends. And a lot of guys in the S390 mail group, they are fantastic people. If you have any question, just go to the Yahoo groups for S390 or for MVS, the separate groups, and ask a question, and they're more than happy to help and explain how stuff works. Moshe Bar, which is of the MOSIX channel, Sam Gollop. And Sam Gollop has been the maintainer of the CBT tape. And the CBT tape is sort of the first distribution in the world ever, because he has been maintaining this for 25 years, and the guy before him for 18 years. So in total, you've now 42 years of maintenance on a computer tape with tooling scripts for mainframe. So if you think that Yggdrasil with Slackware was the first Linux distribution, yeah, Linux distribution it was, but not the first distribution. Those guys win it by a long slide. In short, it's a wonderful new world, and it's for both for fun and for profit. So, thanks for your attention. Are there any questions? Yeah.
Why not to run Linux?
Sorry, what?
Why not to run Linux under Hercules?
Yeah, why would I? I would have a Linux system than Hercules emulator, then Linux on top of that. I know it's possible, but why would that be of any interest? The performance would suck, and it would not give me anything more than that I already have on my my own Linux systems.
Thanks.
No more questions. If there are no more questions, then I've done a really excellent talk because I explained everything. All people are thinking, "Oh, this guy is really mental," and I have. How can I ever ask any question? That's also, of course, a possibility. No questions? Okay. Well, thanks for your attention then, and have a lovely day.